Assalamu alaikum. In today's lecture, we shall talk about some properties of ferromagnetic materials. We start with the magnetization curve. In previous lectures, we learned that magnetic flux density is proportional to the magnetic field strength. And the proportionality constant that is denoted by mu and is called permeability. Permeability of a free space that is denoted by mu naught, and its value is 4 pi into 10 raised to the power minus 7. For some ferromagnetic materials, this permeability can be much higher than this one. So we define relative permeability. A relative permeability for some ferromagnetic materials can be much higher. For example, for steel, it is of the orders of 6000. Here we have assumed that this permeability is constant. However, for magnetic materials, this is not actually a constant. To further elaborate this point, let's consider this magnetic circuit. This consists of a core on which a current carrying conductor is wound. So what we do is we gradually increase the current from zero up to some maximum allowed current, and plot a graph between the MMF, applied MMF. We know that MMF is equal to number of turns multiplied by current. So MMF is proportional to current. So we gradually increase current, MMF will increase, and we will observe the flux in this core. The units for MMF is ampere turns per ampere turns. So what we observe is that initially, by increasing MMF, flux increases almost linearly with the MMF, and after a certain point, an increase in MMF does not result into significant increase in flux. That is, we have this situation. This region, in this region, an increase in MMF results into proportionate increase in the flux. And this region is called linear region. However, after this point, an increase in MMF will not result into significant change in flux, and this region is called the saturation region. And at this point is called the knee of the curve. Machines are generally designed to operate at the knee of the curve so as to have maximum performance out of that machine. So this curve, the curve between MMF and the flux, is not a linear curve. Rather, it has something shaped like this one, and this curve is called the magnetization curve. How we can obtain a relation between flux density and magnetic field strength? We know that this B is equal to flux over A. That is, B is proportional to flux. And likewise, this magnetic field strength H is equal to MMF over L. That is, H is proportional to MMF. So here is curve between MMF and flux. What do you think should be the shape of the curve between magnetic field strength and flux density? The units for flux density is Tesla, and units for this is ampere turns per meter. So what do you think is the shape of the curve between these two quantities, that is flux magnetic field strength and flux density? Since H is proportional to F, and b is proportional to phi. Therefore, the shape of the curve between these two quantities will be the same as this one, that is this curve. So these two curves are very useful in the design of electrical machines. From here, we can see that this relation between the ratio between B and H, that is mu is B over H, that is not a constant. Rather, if we plot it, if we plot mu as a function of H, we will observe that in this region, this ratio B over H is larger, and then here it this ratio becomes smaller and smaller and smaller as there is this H increases. However, B is not increasing proportionately. So mu is not constant, rather it is function of H, and in this region, linear region, it is approximately it can be considered to be equal to a constant. Since our designs, most of the designs will be in this region, so we will be taking mu to be constant in most of the cases. Another very important thing in ferromagnetic materials is hysteresis. Let's discuss that. To explain hysteresis, we consider again this magnetic circuit. However, now we do not apply a DC current to this, rather we apply an AC current, that is this sinusoidal current to, we apply this sinusoidal current to this conductor, and again plot the magnetization curve for it. So as current increases, MMF will increase because MMF is equal to number of turns into current, and hence H will also increase. H is equal to MMF over length. So an increase in H will result into increase in flux density. How would it increase? We know that B and H are related to each other by this magnetization curve. So an increase in magnetic field strength results into an increase in flux density. However, this increase is not linear increase. These two quantities are related to each other by the magnetization curve, as we have already discussed. Now, when once the current reaches its maximum, then it is decreasing. With the decrease in current, MMF will decrease and H will also decrease. A decrease in H will result into decrease in flux density. However, this decrease is not in the same fashion as it was during the increase of current, rather it follows a different path. So when current becomes zero, then after that it is becoming negative. Negative means MMF in opposite direction and H in opposite direction. So this will result into flow of flux in the opposite direction, and then when we reach this maximum, then there is again an increase in the current, and this is the situation. That is, the path followed is not the same during the increase of current and during the decrease of the current. So this curve is called hysteresis. This effect is called hysteresis, and this curve is called hysteresis curve. Here what we observe is that at this point, MMF is zero. This on this axis we have H, and if we have a curve between MMF and flux, we shall again get the same curve, similar curve. So here MMF is zero, but flux density, flux is not equal to zero. There is some, still some flux. This flux is called residual flux. That is, we have removed removed the current, but still some flux is flowing. This flux is called residual flux. This is how permanent magnets are produced. We magnetize them, and when we remove the MMF, they are still magnetized. To demagnetize it, what we have to do is we have to apply an MMF in opposite direction. So this MMF is called coercive MMF. If we want to produce permanent magnets, we would like to have more residual flux. That is, to produce permanent magnets, we would like to prefer a material which has a hysteresis curve, for example, like this one. For producing permanent magnets, we would like to have a we would like to use ferromagnetic material with this hysteresis curve, this blue curve, so that we have more residual flux, and we need to apply more MMF in reverse direction to demagnetize it. So now the question is, why does it happen? To answer it, there are different theories. The one which is more famous was proposed by Webers and Irving. This theory states that in ferromagnetic materials there are small domains, and in a domain all atoms have the magnetic field of all atoms in that particular domain are aligned, such that these domains behave as small magnets. Arbitrarily, these domains are randomly aligned. These are small domains in a ferromagnetic material, and these domains behave as small magnets. Ordinarily, these domains are randomly aligned, and so that their magnetic fields are cancelled out. When we apply an external magnetic field to this ferromagnetic material, what happens is that due to application of these magnetic fields, these domains get themselves aligned with the applied magnetic field. So this is the magnetic field due to the external magnet, and due to application of this magnetic field, these domains get themselves aligned with the applied magnetic field. So these domains will be aligned, and what will happen is that now net flux is flux due to the applied magnets and flux due to the magnetic field due to the domains. Hence, in this region, when we increase MMF, domains get aligned and flux increases, because there is a flux due to these magnets, and there is a flux due to these magnetic field due to this domains, these domains. If you increase the strength of this magnetic field, more and more domains get themselves aligned with the applied magnetic field, and hence the flux increases. After all the domains have aligned themselves, further increase in the applied magnetic field strength will not result into further alignment of the domains, because all the domains have already aligned themselves, and therefore further increase in MMF does not result into further significant increase in the flux, and due to that we have this saturation curve. What happens is when we reduce the applied MMF, when we, for example, remove the applied MMF, some of the domains are still aligned, others get randomly aligned, but some of them are still aligned. So some flux will still flow due to the magnetic field of the domains. This flux is the residual flux. That is, we have removed the external magnetic field, some domains are still aligned, and there is some still some flux here. To demagnetize it, to demagnetize this ferromagnetic material, we have to apply an MMF in opposite direction so that all the domains are again randomly aligned and there is no flux. Or we can apply some other kind of energy to get them randomly aligned. For example, we can heat this ferromagnetic material, we can apply a heavy jerk on this ferromagnetic material so that all the domains get randomly aligned. So this phenomena again happens if we increase the applied MMF in opposite direction. Again, domains will get aligned in opposite direction, and flux, there will be more flux in the opposite direction. This alignment and again misalignment that results into consumption of energy, that results into losses, and those losses are called hysteresis losses. That is, energy required to align and then misalign these domains, that energy is called hysteresis loss. That hysteresis loss is proportional to the area enclosed by hysteresis loop. That is, more is the area of the loop, more will be losses, and smaller is the area, smaller will be losses. In this particular case, this ferromagnetic material, which has this hysteresis loop that is shown by the black curve, that will have less losses compared to the one with this one. Therefore, for the design of electrical machines, we would like to have ferromagnetic material with small area of this loop. So this is opposite to the case of material required for generating permanent magnets. In addition to these losses, there are other losses in ferromagnetic materials, which are, for example, eddy current losses. These eddy current losses are due to changes in the magnetic field. We shall discuss these losses in more details in one of the later lecture. These two losses together, that is the hysteresis loss and eddy current loss, these are there in the core of the machine and are called core losses. We shall discuss about eddy current losses in more details in one of our later lectures.